Have you ever wondered how you can turn all the data generated by devices in your home or office into a single visualization where you can see and understand all the activity happening on your network? Analyzing network traffic lets you troubleshoot network connectivity issues, monitor user behavior, and even hunt and find threats lurking on your network. But to do this, you need to learn how to collect packet captures. And in this video, I'm going to show you three ways to do it. The first way is where you collect packets directly off an asset already on the network. For example, your computer, which is already joined to the network via Wi-Fi or maybe Ethernet. One of the advantages is you have immediate access to the packets. I created a small home office LAN setup here on this table. This consisted of a TP-Link Wi-Fi router, and I ran a cable from the WAN port of the router to an open port on my pfSense firewall. Then added a Netgear GS105E managed switch connected to the LAN port of the router and the other end connected to the switch itself. I added a laptop connected to the same switch via Ethernet, the yellow wire, an internet camera connected to the switch via Ethernet, the blue wire, a Netgear ReadyNAS network storage device connected to the switch, the gray wire, and I added a smartphone and connected it to the Wi-Fi signal coming from the router. Okay, so I'm going to open up the laptop that's connected directly to the network. This is a Windows 11 laptop. I'm going to open up Wireshark and use it for my capture. Now, Wireshark is not the only way to capture packets. You can use command line tools like TCP dump for Linux or Mac OS or NetSH for Windows. But we're going to go ahead and use Wireshark now. I'm going to go ahead and open up capture options. I want to find my Ethernet connection because that laptop on the table is connected to the switch over Ethernet. And I'm going to note that promiscuous mode is enabled on this interface. Promiscuous mode will allow the interface to latch on any other packets that come by and gives us a much more interesting capture. I'm going to start the capture right away that I've got some packets that are flowing into the interface. I'm going to go ahead and let this run for 2 minutes. I am going to go ahead and stop the capture and I'm going to save. Now I'm ready to do some analysis. Wireshark provides a lot of expert tools to sift through and filter this traffic, but this is pretty low level stuff and very technical. And what I want to do is get a nice visual model of the network and everything that's happening. So I went to Teleseer, took this same PCAP file, dropped it in, and this is what came up. I could see right away that I've got a map, a number of assets, protocols summarized here. This is my Windows laptop where we did the direct capture. I could see we also have a neighboring asset, OB1. Teleseer is automatically classified it by its manufacturer, Netgear. I know that is my ReadyNAS network attached storage device. If I zoom out, there's some asset here. If I click it, Teleseer has also fingerprinted this as the TP-Link router. So this is the router that was on the table. You can see all of its traffic here. If I look up even further, there's an internet icon and icons representing external hosts. So these are the destinations that we're reaching out and talking. Here under the timeline, I have all the flows that happen inside of this same PCAP. So I can start to get an idea of what kind of traffic was being collected when I was doing this direct capture. So for example, if I want to know what was going on with OB1 here, I could click that and I could see that it was exchanging some peer-to-peer connection. So I know that is a common protocol that ReadyNAS uses. I know for a fact that it's enabled so you could do file transfers and video transfers and things like that. So there's a lot of information I get here just from a direct capture. Okay, so this is a great way to get some packets. What are the limitations? First of all, you have a pretty narrow vantage point when you do a direct capture. You're really limiting yourself to capturing around the assets interface. Two, this is typically an on-demand method, meaning you're not going to use this for continuous traffic monitoring over a long period of time. And number three, you have to have access to the endpoint. Sounds easy enough, but oftentimes you can't really get onto someone's computer. What if you don't have access to the endpoint? That's going to lead us to our second technique, which is capturing with a span port. A span port is a type of port mirroring where all the traffic from all the ports on a device are copied or mirrored on a single port for ease of capture. A span port offers a number of advantages. Number one, you don't need access to any assets in the network. If you have access to the network device, you sort of have access to all their traffic. This is obviously an advantage if you have assets that are locked away behind closed doors or offices. Number two, you can gather all the packets from all the devices simultaneously, which is very helpful in investigations where you're looking for lateral movement or common problems across multiple assets at a time. Now, a span port requires a special type of switching logic, usually referred to as a managed switch. I have an example here. So this is the GS105 Netgear switch that we've been using in the table setup. You can see how it's a ProSafe switch, but then it also has plus switch, which indicates that it is a managed switch. I have the unmanaged little brother of the same switch. It's a ProSafe 5 as well. This is a GS105 without that extra E. To capture on a span, you need to designate one of the ports on the switch to be the mirror. In this case, I chose port 5. I then hook up my analysis or capture laptop directed to that port, with the other end hooked to an Ethernet dongle on my Mac. I then have to configure that same Ethernet dongle on a static IP because the managed switch has its own private network it uses for management. In this case, that managed subnet is 192.168.100.0/24. So I chose an IP on that subnet. Then I go to the IP address of the switch itself, log in, and I present it with a management GUI very similar to a Wi-Fi router. So if I go under monitoring, mirroring, I can see that ports 1, 2, 3, 4 are all set up to mirror on destination port 5. That is the span. Port 1 is the upstream router. Port 2 is the laptop. Port 3 is the internet camera. Port 4 is the Ready NAS. Come over to Wireshark, start a capture. I need to select the Ethernet dongle on my Mac as my capture interface, and I start. And I can see immediately that traffic is flowing in. I've got a lot of different IPs presented here. So I'm going to let this thing roll for a while, then we'll see what we got. So I've opened up the span packet capture in Teleseer. And if I zoom in right away, I can see I have my tabletop network and my Windows computer here, the network camera and all of its traffic down here below. I have the Ready NAS network attached storage and all of its traffic. And I can see that we also picked up the iPhone in this capture, which is interesting because the iPhone's not connected to the switch. It's actually connected to the Wi-Fi router on the table, but it still shows up in the traffic because the router is communicating with it and we're picking it up in the capture. Now, next door, you'll see another broadcast domain here. This is my Mac computer that I use to connect to that span port. So we're picking up the spanning private network, the control plane, if you will, as well. This is the TP-Link Wi-Fi router itself on the table. We're picking up it and all of its traffic. And if we zoom out, we have all the external hosts that the various devices connected to during the capture. If you look down here below, we have a lot more protocols and a lot more traffic now because we have a much broader view of the network. We're picking up all those requests, DNS communications protocols in this capture. If I pop over to the external host, I can get more detail about each of these, what country they're in, what are the domains, who are they owned by. And you'll also notice that in this capture, we picked up some events. So Teleseer has picked up some authentication events in here as well. The span technique has allowed us to get a much broader number of assets as well as protocols. So what are the limitations of using a span for a packet collection? Number one, the switch has to be a managed switch with the appropriate configuration options to set up the span port. Number two, you have to have access to the switch itself. So physical access means getting into a secure network closet or a data center, finding out where these switches are. And then once you have access, you have to get the passwords. Number three, computing power of a switch has to be sufficient so that you can mirror without dropping anything. In a very heavy network, the span is not going to keep up with both the normal traffic and making a copy of each of those packets. So you will drop packets in high throughput, high bandwidth situations. What do you do if your switch doesn't support spanning, or it's not managed, or you do have a high performance situation with heavy links? You need to make sure that you have an absolute robust deployment. That's going to lead to our third technique, network taps. A tap is a special networking device that is put in line on an existing link in the network where it creates a copy of every packet that flows across that wire. In this video, I'm going to be using the Dualcomm ETAP 2003. It has two ports on one side. This is where the wire comes in and the wire goes out to its current destination. On the other side of the device is another port where you're going to hook in your analysis laptop. It doesn't require any structural changes to the network. You only have to have access to a port and a wire, which is typically easier to find and get permission to use. Number two is it doesn't require any access to an asset. You just have to have access to the wire. The first thing I'm gonna do is provide power to the tap. I then identify a link I wanna tap. In this case, I'm removing the link between the switch and the router, and I'm adding a new link from the router to the tap, and then from the tap back to the switch. I then plug in the tap's collection port into the Ethernet dongle of my analysis capture laptop. I then open up Wireshark on my capture computer, capture, options, go to my Ethernet, Now, I do want to point out in this case, with this particular tab, I don't need a static IP and I could just leave my Ethernet interface set to DHCP. So I know with my interface here under capture options, I have a hot spark line. So that's a good sign. I'm going to go ahead and start the capture and I can recognize right away from the IP space that this is my captured network on the tabletop. So I'm just going to let this run for several minutes. Then I'm going to save the PCAP. Then I'll import to Teleseer. So switching over, you can see that we have a very similar network to that of the SPAN. We have our four primary devices on the table itself. Here's my Windows computer. There's the iPhone, the ReadyNAS, and the camera. I have my capture laptop. And I can see I have this mysterious MAC address without an IP. So it turns out that asset recently communicated with the capture computer. So what I did is I verified that by going to my capture computer, in this case, my Mac, Scarif. I did a ARP-A, which shows the recent entries in the ARP table, and I found the mysterious address, and I can recognize this as being one of the IPs that my Mac has recently communicated with. It had nothing to do with the table network, but it was in the stream and Teleseer picked it up. I left it in there just as an artifact to show you that sometimes you do get some stray voltage in captures and you have to think about what's happening to rule out some of the obvious traffic. We get all the other goodies. We've got the timeline. I have the events here, got the external host, my inventory and connections. So the tap is also doing a very good job of allowing us to see what's happening on this network. So what are the limitations of using a tap? Number one, you might not have access to the network. And while it might be easier to tap a network than say, bring in a specialized SPAN switch or other equipment, sometimes you just don't have physical access due to security constraints, or perhaps you're working remotely. Number two, a high-performance tap can be pricey. Not all taps are created equal. In order to have the throughput and the juice to do the tapping, sometimes it requires a more expensive tap. Depends on your situation. So it might not be the most affordable option. So which of these methods should you use? All things being equal, a high-performance tap used at multiple capture points is going to be your best bet. Now, that being said, understanding how to make a good direct capture is an essential skill. It will help you troubleshoot and visualize behaviors in a lot of different situations. And sometimes it's best to understand what's happening with a single asset first, then scale that understanding up to a tap network to really understand what's happening. And there is no one-size-fits-all solution. So collect where you can using all three techniques and then merge all those collections into a single picture. Here in this project, you can see how I've combined all three of my capture files, my direct, my span, and my tap into a single project. Teleseer takes care of all the asset identification, deduplication, fingerprinting. It'll update to give you a single unified project with all three of those flows over time. This is very handy if you're able to tap from multiple places. You can see a larger network and also look at some of the changes that are taking place over time. Now, I'm interested to hear what you think. Which of these methods have you used? What other techniques and methods have you worked with? Feel free to sound off in the comment section. We're always very eager to hear about your own experiences and comments. Also, check out the description for links to tools and equipment shown in this video. Thanks so much for watching. If you like this content, feel free to give this video a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel. Until next time, take care.